What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel.
Have you ever wondered what would happen if three planes were to land or depart at the same time from some airport? How would the pilots of these planes coordinate the landings with one another? Well, let me tell you that they won't. If every plane near a certain airport must know of all the planes around it, the pilot of this plane will need way more than a co-pilot to help him fly that plane, trust me on that. So, with that said, how do pilots know when and where should they land if they have no idea of other planes surrounding them? What if another plane is landing right now? The answer lies within airports' traffic control rooms. You see, pilots of aircraft that approach or depart the airport area don't communicate directly with one another. Instead, they speak to a controller who is sitting in his tall tower somewhere near the airstrip. Without him, pilots would need to be aware of every plane and would need to discuss landing priorities with lots of other pilots. This controller, the air traffic controller, plays the role of a mediator. His job is to be the in-between kind of guy, the single point of contact for all the pilots of our planes. And similarly to this air traffic controller, the mediator design pattern defines an object that encapsulates how a set of other objects interact with one another. Now, because this mediator object defines a set of certain behaviors, the mediator pattern is none other than a behavioral design pattern. This pattern restricts direct communications between certain objects and forces them to collaborate only via a mediator object, hence reducing the dependencies between them. Let's go ahead now and try to implement this pattern using a second example that I'm sure you are also very familiar with. Take a UI screen, any user interface screen, let's say this login screen. You see, this view is made of a login button object, two text field objects where the user can input his or her username or password, and two labels which specify where the username and password should each respectively go. Now, when the user clicks on the login button, few authentication checks should be made in the background using the information found inside the text boxes, and the if all is right, the user logs in. Okay, but where does the mediator pattern come in here? You see, the login button class we created contains the logic for fetching the data entered inside the text fields. So this button is now tied to these text fields and cannot be reused without them. However, the button as a whole should be generic. It is generic, and we should have the ability to reuse it across several parts of our app. But with the code we just wrote, we simply can't. To solve this problem, what we have to do is create a mediator or dialogue class in our example, where the dependencies between our different objects, or in this case our different UI components, will sit. As a result, these components will depend only on a single mediator class instead of being coupled to multiple other classes. So, previously, every time a user clicked on the login button, it had to fetch and validate the values of our text fields. Now, its only job is to notify the dialog about the click, and the dialog itself will perform the required validations. We also went a step further here and made the dependency even looser by extracting a common interface for our dialogs. In this interface, you can declare all the methods needed by our components, allowing them to work with any dialog that implements this interface. Let's go ahead now and take a look at the structure or class diagram of the mediator pattern, all while relating it to the login screen example we just gave. The first thing you will notice is, of course, the components of our application. In our example, these components are the button, labels, and text fields of our app. Each component has a reference to the interface of the mediator and isn't aware of the actual mediator's implementation. This way, you can reuse this component in other programs by linking it to a different mediator. Speaking of the mediator interface, its job is to declare the methods in which the means of communication between our components is specified. Components may pass any context as arguments to this method, including their own objects. However, this should be done in a way that no coupling occurs between the receiving component and the sender's class. The third and last piece of this diagram is the concrete mediator. Concrete mediators encapsulate relations between the various components they manage, often keep references to all these components, and sometimes even manage their life cycle. So, to recap, the mediator design pattern lets you extract all the relationships between your classes or components into a separate class. By doing this, your individual components will become unaware of other components, hence decoupling them from one another. They will still be able to communicate with each other, but indirectly and via the mediator object you created. What you will also be able to do is reuse any component in a different app, and to do this you will need to provide it with a new mediator class. And because this mediator class houses all the relations between our components, it's now very easy to define entirely new ways for these components to communicate by introducing a new mediator class. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you on the next one.